being that we're with you in your word and your Holy Spirit is teaching us. I just pray for the gift that you've given to all of us that have human spirits, that our souls will desire to know these things, that will make our life happy and perfect and in your plan. I ask this in Jesus' holy name, who did exactly that. Amen.
Amen.
We are now moving, actually we moved over last week into 15, verse 15, Revelation 15, or 1:15. So let's kind of brush it, and then we'll start the rest of them. I think we've already read two or three verses from last week. His feet were like bronze glowing in the furnace. His voice was like the sound of rushing water. And this is, like we talked, this was a theophany. And this is a part of discipline. The one before we had his eyes with fire in it. So this is discipline of God. And each time that you see this come up, it's the context that always decides what it is. But what you'll see is that whenever you find this wording, you'll find it very specific to the discipline that God is going to be doing. So let's go to Leviticus 26:19. That's the next verse. We've already done Lamentations, I think, and 2 Kings. And
you're not going to cry, are you? I said, you're not going to cry, are you?
No crying.
You're not going to lament.
I'm not going to lament. No lamenting for me. There's a lot of lamenting going on today. So let's go, and this is a very interesting kind of set you up on this thing. The Leviticus 26 is a very interesting book in that it describes what's called the five cycles of discipline, and there's each one of them gets worse, and then what happens is that when a country turns away from God, what happens is discipline is an automatic result of that. As strange as it sounds, God doesn't have to get mad. Justice is designed to get things fixed. Okay. In fact, one of the problems we have as a people, and as a country, is that we tend to distort justice, and that's one of the major problems with our country today. Is that when you do not allow justice to do what it's supposed to do, you end up with people in your country who have no respect, and there's no justice. So people will tend to mock it. And when you have, this is the same thing that happens in the world. So God's not like that. No matter who's doing what, God's justice will prevail. So we may mock justice as Americans, which we do. You look at the judicial system. You look at some of the rubbish that we're doing. We may mock it, but God will not let his justice be mocked, ever. Okay? And I reference one right here to, what is it, right here. We're not going to read this one, but I referenced it for you because it's, you can see it's 6-7 chapters inclusively. And it is all about this exact standard taking place, but all the countries in which God finally comes to the point where he's going to institute that justice. And what this looks like for us, we're more familiar with this. This will sound strange. This is more familiar with us as a That's what it looks like to us in our days. When the world gets unstable and justice is not taken care of, countries, individuals, like we talk about, believers and unbelievers collaborate individually. They make the country doing that, because that's actually what we're doing right now. We're actually on nationality. We've already done the individual part. But we're actually on nationality. And when it doesn't do its job, it actually kind of unbalances the world. And when they don't do their job, which many countries are already doing that way, they become unstable, and they become the consequence of that happens on their country, just like it is ours. Now, one of the nice things about the United States is that we probably have the most powerful economic engine in the entire world, second to nobody. Okay, even the Chinese, who are second, in reality, drain off of ours. They would not exist if it weren't for us. That's why we have such the deficit that we have with them. In reality, it's American consumers that pull that over. Okay. cut. But and it's called capitalism, has a bad name, but actually capitalism is actually very biblical because it has to do with freedom. Anytime you see something restrict freedom, you can usually tell at the heart of restricting freedom is evil all the time. Okay. So let's read this thing. But what happens is that as a person, as a country changes, they actually turn from God in each thing that they do. The discipline gets greater. Okay, and God gives them these warnings. So it goes from here to here, and if they don't turn back, they go from here to here, and if they don't go back, they go from here to here, and finally from here to here. And this is when they, this is typical of this is 721 BC for the Bible people, and 586. Those are ones we're familiar with. This is the Northern Kingdom, right?
Yeah.
This is the Southern Kingdom of Israel. So this is Israel, this is Judah here. And this is when they were wiped out, okay? But before this, there was lots of things that they did wrong, that they turned from God, and finally God said, okay, justice will have its way. And the question we should be asking ourselves, this is kind of a scary thing, is if you actually look at these chapters and you read them, they're listed out pretty good. The first cycle actually starts in 14, and the second one starts in 18. But as you go through these, you can almost look at these things and say, where are we as a nation today? It's kind of scary. If I had to take a guess between it, we're between the fourth and fifth cycle.
That's right.
You know, which is a dangerous place to be. Which means in reality, without the grace of God, and God's grace has kept us here, it's God's grace. God always has grace before judgment. That's what we're about. That's what we're doing. Okay, we are talking about it. We are believers. We are hopefully living a holy life, a life of light of Christ. And by doing that, we are stemming the tide to the fifth cycle. And the more people who walk a holy life as Christians, and I'm not talking about being nice, I'm talking about walking a holy life, the more Christians who do that, the better chance this has of going back, of actually being restored. But my personal opinion, when I look at some of this stuff should have taken place about 40 years ago. We actually, in my personal opinion, should have slipped into the fifth cycle of discipline about 40 years ago. So the question you have to ask yourself is, why didn't we? Other than the grace of God. Okay? I'm not going to tell you why I think it's true, but this is where we're teetering. In reality, my personal opinion, looking at everything we have today, the United States could come to an end any day, anytime, just like that.
Yes.
You can see some of that in the very simple things what's that day, 9/11? Where you have a very small group of people, some of the most horrible people who have ever lived, the evil of evils, have such an impact on a great country like ours.
It's only 19 now, people.
Huh?
Only 19 people.
Yeah, not many people. But you look at the impact, and the impact since that time.
Yeah.
And that is happening because we are in this cycle. And one of the things that you know, in fact, if you're familiar with Habakkuk, Habakkuk chapter 2, has a very interesting piece in it where, if you remember in chapter 1, Habakkuk is pleading to God saying, Lord, when are you going to intervene on behalf of the Jews? When are you going to intervene on behalf of us Jews who love you? Because there were so many horrible things going on. Murder, thievery, idolatry was horrible. Children's sacrifices. Bad, bad stuff, okay? The Lord responds to him and says, don't worry about it, Habakkuk. I've got it covered. I'm going to send the Babylonians, and they're going to kick your city's butt. And all of a sudden, Habakkuk's just, wait a minute. But they're such evil people. They're so evil. Why would you have, Lord? See, his tone is changing. Okay, he's gone from, just got to do something. You got to do something, Lord. And all of a sudden, he's going, wait a minute. The Babylonians? These are the most horrible people in the world. Why would you have the wicked, evil Babylonians punishing God's people? Well, that's what happened, right? But he finally figures out, and the truth is, if you look at things like the Northern Kingdom, who were the punishers of the Northern Kingdom?
Assyrians.
The Assyrians. Remember the Assyrians? They're the ones who Jonah tried to change. Actually, he did change it for 100 years. Okay, but after that fourth generation, they turned back to the evil ways. Some of the things they used to do is this. They were the most feared people on the face of the earth. That's why Jonah hated them. They were feared. They didn't lose a battle for like 200 years. They skinned their people alive. That was part of their play stuff. So you want to get somebody to talk, you skin them alive. And the real part is that you have to try to skin them alive and not kill them. That takes real expertise, apparently. So they didn't use waterboarding, so that was too simple. It doesn't get anything. But you get the point. Here God takes the most ruthless nation in the world to punish them. And here he does it, 100 and whatever that is years later, a little more than 100 years later. He does the exact same thing with the ruthless people. And if you look at us, and we look at this country, you have to look at some of this stuff just to match yourself up. You have to look at something like, a lot of us were in the service at this time. You look at something like the Korean War. Korean War ended up being a stalemate. Reality, we walked away from it. Vietnam War. Here you have a people who barely have anything. Yet they had the ability, because of our degeneration on our side, we actually kind of missed the point of the war to win it. Okay, so we didn't let our guys win it, just like all the wars we've been in since. And so ultimately you have this small, tiny nation that nobody even knew who it was, stand still, the greatest army in the world. How is that possible? And you have ISIS. So you get an idea of how God does not take a next strong nation to beat us. He takes something right out of the pit of hell, some little tiny thing, and that's what he takes. Because it's meant to embarrass. It's meant to show that the arrogance and the proudness has to be dealt with in a very severe way. And that's what he does. So that's what I say. We need to be very careful. If we fall, I don't think it's going to be anything big. It's going to be something stupid. It's going to be embarrassing. It's going to be unholy from our point of view. It'll be like Habakkuk. Lord, how could you? That same thing. So let's read it. Gives you some idea what this is. We're going to read 26:9. It says, I will break down your stubborn pride and make the sky above you like iron and the ground beneath you like bronze. Your strength will be spent in vain because your soil will not yield its crops, nor will the trees of the land yield their fruit. And this is the part we're talking about, economic. This is an economic picture, the bronze on the bottom, the steel on the top, the iron on the top, the very similar to no rain and actually a famine was happening. So what this tells us is that this is done by God. Okay, this didn't just happen. This is done by God. If you look at Elijah, he had a very similar thing when he held up the water. Okay, his country was in complete reversion. How do you know that? Well, Ahab was there. Jezebel was there. All the Baal priests were there. Okay, to the point that he had to take it to that. So it gives you some idea of what the symbolism in this one is about the bronze. It is a picture of economic discipline by God, okay? And the interesting thing about it, and we'll run into it in other places, but I'll tell you about it. If you read this whole thing, it's very interesting. But one of the interesting things you find is that God takes care of and blesses and keeps the people who are faithful to him, okay? He just does. And do we have examples of that? Yeah, they're all over the place. I mean, look at Daniel. Look at the book of Daniel. Daniel's is one of the very first people taken before this took place. He was taken out in the first exile, about 606 BC. And he was taken out as well as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he was faithful to God, right? I mean, in their country, what's strange to me about that, in Daniel's time, his country was a theocracy. You want to have that's important to Daniel? It means that for him, God is the ruler. Okay, now think about this. Okay, Babylonian comes over, conquers it, takes all of their princes, and Daniel was a prince, you remember that part, takes all their princes, and takes them with him. So as far as from Daniel's point of view, he has been ripped away from his family, his city has been conquered, his country has been conquered. You should be asking yourself, why would this young man love the Lord? Why would he put him first? You read chapter 2, he puts his life on the line just to keep the Mosaic law with respect to his food. And he does it, if you look at the way he does it, he's not arrogant, he's not nasty, he's not resentful, he does it absolutely honorable. Absolutely. That's an important thing to remember, is that even when you are in the face of the enemy, your responsibility is to be honorable. Because God respects that. That's what he wants from us. In reality, we are required to do that. It is a minimum standard. I don't like that particular part, but it's true. God says it's true, it's true, whether I like it or not. But he was very honorable. God kept him, protected him, raised him, and all of them, right? They became leaders. In fact, when that kingdom was destroyed, who pops out on the other side?
Daniel.
He, at the time of the exile comes in, he's the only guy standing, right? So it tells you, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the same, many believers are exactly that, is that the world can be falling apart around you, but God will keep you. Okay? Now that is for those who walk with God. Okay? Now, not all believers walk with God. And they don't. My principle is about 94% of Christians today, my personal opinion, do not walk with God. They don't even know what God wants from them, nor do they care. That sounds kind of harsh. Why do I think they don't care? Because I know that God says that anybody who seeks me finds me. Yeah, anybody who seeks me finds me. Okay? So the people who do not find God are the people who
don't seek him.
Yeah, that's true. That's an axiom right there. So in reality, in my personal opinion, there are 6% of the people who are Christians today who make up 100% of the impact of Christianity in this country.
Of those who call themselves Christians, only 6%.
Or even maybe they are. I don't know. I don't want to call them one way or the other, only because I think it's dangerous territory.
Distinguishable between...
The Lord knows
believer.
Who these people are. Yeah.
Yes. And a Christian.
Yeah. Hopefully, if they were a tree, they'd have a couple fruits. Right? Out there. just saying. But, and I think a lot of this is because, and this 6% is, in my personal opinion, the 6% will drop.
That's so clearly revealed, though, in what we have for culture today.
I don't know if you keep up with any of the so-called... evangelical papers, but there has been, I think, almost 8 revivals in the United States. All of them were false. All of them were false. There was a great big one in Brownsville in Florida.
Brownsville, Texas?
And there's one in Texas, too. There's a Brownsville, Texas. This isn't one in Florida. They hyped it all over the radio and the Christian networks and everything, and it fizzled out. No one was actually saved.
Yeah.
And all we do now is we turn on our television set and if you want to watch Christian programming, most of them are, mega churches who are putting on a song fest, and many people are raising and dancing around like natives without a spear. And, they do is make a lot of noise and nothing is said about the Lord.
Yeah.
All these motivational speakers, yeah. Joyce Myers,
Joel Osteen,
Benny Hinn.
I agree 100%. Those are the signs. The question you have to ask yourself is, why is this true? And to me, there's a verse. I think it's Hosea. I don't know if it's 6:4 or 4:6, but somebody will look it up. It says, "My people are destroyed for
lack of knowledge.
That's right. The problem we have today is that Christians do not know how to live a holy life. They don't know how. Why? It's not taught. What does God expect from me? Okay? If you ever listen to me much, one of the things that you'll hear is that I'm going to say this in an absurd way, just so that you get the point, okay? I'm a person who does not like the Old Testament for Christians, okay? And I actually love the Old Testament. I spend a lot of time in it. I'm actually studying it, have been studying it. But my point is that what God has for Christians is not found in the Old Testament.
That's true, right, yeah.
And is not
that's
found,
yeah.
dare I say, in the Gospels.
In the Gospels.
That's not our protocol, okay? If it was, what Jesus did in Matthew, Mark, and Luke is what we should be doing. We should be running off to the temple. Oh, that's right. We don't have one. Okay, so my whole point is that Christianity needs to teach Christianity. Christians should not be spending any time in the Old Testament, listen to the second part of this, until they know exactly what God requires of them in the New Testament, starting about halfway through John. From halfway through John, maybe about 20%, you can go through John to the end, and that's all yours. This is yours. When you know what God wants from you, when you understand the mystery doctrines, those are the doctrines that God gave to Paul, that he says were never, ever revealed prior to him revealing them. Guess where they're at?
Testament.
New Testament, way past John. Mm-hmm. 1 Corinthians is the first one. Okay? So these are the things we're suffering from here. We don't know what God has for us because we're ignorant of it. And that's what half the problem is. Half the problem is that, I'd say 98%. The biggest problem is that we don't know what God requires of us. We don't know what God holds us responsible for. So this is my big joke about being nice. Stop being nice. Start being holy. And when you're holy, guess what?
You'll be nice.
You'll be nice. That's right.
Automatic.
Because that's how it follows. That's how true niceness comes. Okay? So let's move on. Let's go to Daniel. I don't know how I got there. Good thing to get there, right? Let's go to Daniel, chapter 4:15.
I subscribe to the JP on my phone. Jerusalem Post, mm-hmm. and they had this guy making a spiel, you know, because of all their problems. He's giving the idea out that we should listen to our prophets, you know, and da-da-da-da-da-da. No mention about what happened after the prophets all disappeared, except the last one.
Right, right. You should listen to the last prophet you didn't write about.
That's right.
Yeah.
And so they're lost as dodo birds.
Right. They are. And, you know, even if they read their own scripture, they would find that they're in trouble. They'd sit there and say, where's the Aaron priesthood? Where's the temple? What should we be doing? They should be very concerned.
Yeah.
For thousands of years. Yet they're not. So yeah, it's interesting. I like the word interesting because you know the nice thing about if you know who God is and you understand the scriptures and you understand especially the next chapters two after this one, you can look at the whole world and say, Jesus Christ is absolutely in control of history. He is absolutely in control of it. Okay? There is never a time when your life falls off the shelf. It's always there. You put yourself there by believing in him and walking with him and he keeps you. Amen. Everybody else is like the chaff that the wind blows away. Okay? You remember that's
right.
Psalm 1. Okay? But that's what happens. If you want to know how God looks at us different than people who aren't believers, he says it. It's like the chaff that the wind blows away. That's what it's worth. And you see God deal with that if you've ever spent any time in Exodus, Numbers, any of the Joshua. You kind of go on and on. You see how God deals with that. But even with us, with believers, there are the ones who walk with him and those who are believers, okay, believers, the enemies of Christ. That one in Romans, is it 16? I think it's 16. It's either 15 or 16. The enemies of the cross is a reference to believers. It is not a reference to unbelievers. Okay? These people are the part that God treats like the chaff when bad things happen. They have to be removed. Why? Because this cannot be strong if they are still around. So God wipes them out. He starts over. This is the principle called what? The remnant. The remnant. God just needs a remnant. He just needs enough. Now, he doesn't really need enough. If you remember the conversation with Moses, and so it was, God could take rocks and do a better job. Okay, he doesn't really need us. I mean, we are dust, by the way. But he gives us the opportunity. That's what he gives us. He gives us the opportunity to walk with him, to have a blessed life, to make an eternal difference in both time and in eternity. It's a choice. We were talking to my son today. My son Andrew's down here. We were talking about, you know, you have a choice. You have a freedom. Choose as you will, but you have a choice. But make sure you understand the choice that you're making. Okay? And that's what we need to do. We need to think about it. We need to decide whether this side or that side. We as Christians need to humble ourselves before God and say, Lord, let me know. What am I doing wrong? Show me. I do not want to be counted in the riffraff. And I'm talking about the believing side. I'm not even including the chaff. Okay, that's the chaff up there. So that's the whole point. That's the whole point of the thing. So let's get to Daniel. Where are we at, Daniel? Okay, Daniel 4:15. Oh, yeah. Little tiny words. Here we go. I should have you read this.
You need one of these.
But let the stump, I mean, this is a vision. But let the stump and its roots be bound with iron and bronze. See, we came up with that again. Remain in the ground, in the grass in the field. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven. And let him live as an animal among the plants of the earth. Let his mind be changed from a man to that given to the mind of an animal until seven times passes by him. That's his dream. We all know who that is, right? That's Nebuchadnezzar. And
turned into a cow.
That's right. He's just out there. He looks worse than a cow. I mean, his hair is like a rat's nest. His nails, I mean, he looks... Here is the most powerful, obviously a genius, hands-down genius. And Daniel tells him, he says, you know, that dream, that's your dream. You need to pay attention. God's trying to get your attention. And he's not just doing it to a regular person. This is the man who is the first kingdom of gold of the Gentile nations, the most powerful, pure empire in human history other than Jesus Christ in the millennium. That's why it's the head of gold.
You're talking about the statue of gold.
Yeah, talking about the statue of gold, yeah. Sorry. I thought everybody knew that. I should move right into that. Yeah, the statue of gold. Remember the statue? Mm-hmm. And if you remember, there's lots of interesting things about that. But and if you remember what happens, remember Daniel tells him, he says, Neb, because they're really close, you know. He says, I don't want to break it to you, but you're not that powerful. The Lord, he can make anybody king. He makes them rise, and he brings them up, and he drops them down. He does that. Okay, he's trying to give him some help here. So let's look at 23. And now he's trying to talk. Now Daniel is interpreting the dream. And I really wanted to get you to the point of the bronze and the iron. So you can see that this is a national discipline of a national figure. Okay.
Do you remember Saddam Hussein? Uh-huh. He was one of the most powerful leaders in the Middle East.
Right.
What happened to him at the end of his life? He's living in a hole, and he has so much hair, they had to fumigate him to get him out.
He did. He looked like, yeah. I think it was a Nebuchadnezzar picture.
That's right.
Yeah, but yeah, I remember that. That was pretty bad. You, O king, saw a messenger. He's talking to him, a holy one, coming down from heaven and saying, cut down the tree, destroy it. He is the tree, if you remember. Mm-hmm. When you walk with God, you become that tree. You become that tree that shadows. You become that tree. It's like in Psalms 1. You become the tree that's planted by water that yields its fruit in season. His leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. That's us. When you walk with God, you protect your children. You protect people around you. You provide for them because you are that tree. God has that very same thing. That when you walk with him, he makes your life like that. He protects and blesses people through you. Okay? And what he's trying to tell him is that, you know something, that was you, but you were arrogant. And this is what, so he's telling him what his dream is. But the whole piece of the part, we've already read this already, it was bound with iron and bronze in the grass of the field, and he tells him the same thing. Now, what's really interesting to me is that when he had the dream, which scared him to death, and he gave that dream to Daniel, and Daniel said, let me tell you what that dream means. And he reads him exactly what it says. And Nebuchadnezzar goes, I don't think so. Okay. If you remember what it says after here, almost a year to the day, he hears a voice. Remember, he hears a voice. And that's when, just like that, and he becomes that animal. Everybody's, he's crazy, as far as everybody else is concerned to him. They get the crazy king out of there, and he lives out in that field like an animal. What I think is really cool about it, I'm just going to tell you because it's a cool piece, is that when Nebuchadnezzar's out there, he's nuttier than a fruitcake. You know? He's absolutely wacky. He has no mentality. He is completely psychotic. Okay? I mean, think about it. You know, it's like 7 years he's out there. But when those 7 years are over, there's a part of his mentality, little tiny grain of it, that God preserves. And what happens with that little grain of mentality is that he reaches out and he believes in Jesus Christ. And it says there, if you read the rest of this, that it changes him completely. Right now his mentality is restored to him. He has the ability, he goes and gets a haircut, and gets well cleaned up. He takes over his kingdom again, which had kind of been on standby. Okay, it's the greatest empire in the world, by the way. And what it says here is that God gives him that and more after he's restored him. So that's good news. What that means is that whenever you really screw up and you turn back to God, he has a blessing he's going to bring from it. It's all over the scriptures. And if you remember the other part, this chapter right here, chapter 4, is written by Nebuchadnezzar. It's an evangelistic track. So who would think that God would use Nebuchadnezzar to evangelize? These are the words of Nebuchadnezzar in chapter 4. It's kind of interesting. So God takes him all the way to the top, drops him all the way to the bottom, and then brings him all the way back up again to be a man of God. So when we get to heaven, we'll see him there. But it is interesting that he goes through this exact same thing. Let's go to Daniel 10:6. Now this is a very similar theophany. And I'm only bringing it up because it has some of the same stuff in it. But I also want to show you where it fits too. This is theophany. This is Jesus Christ, the incarnate, pre-incarnate. That is actually his vision, part of his final vision. And it says his body was like crystal light, and his face was like lightning. His eyes like flaming torches. His arms and his legs gleam with burnished bronze. There's the bronze again. And his voice like the sound of a multitude. That's the next piece, remember? That's the next piece we're covering, the multitude from the sound. But if you look at the beginning of this chapter, anybody remember what his vision is? Let's see, Battle of Armageddon. This is the first revelation to anybody that there is a battle revelation, Armageddon. And if you remember what happens, it freaks him out so much that this is the one he says to me, he says, at the time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. This is just a vision that God gave him. He says, I ate no choice food, no meat, wine did not touch my lips, and I used no lotion at all until the 3 weeks were over. Okay. And then on the 24th day of the first month, God sends Gabriel in a theophany to walk him through that. But here is the most spiritual, mature person in the world. And yet when God gave him the vision of the Battle of Armageddon, it freaked him out. But when God showed up in the theophany, he shows up in the attire, virtually identical to what we're looking at right now. Because it is the apparel and it is the vision of discipline, of national discipline. Okay? And that national discipline is specifically for Israel. So, let's just take a brief look at this one. One of the things that came up with my wife asked me this, and it was a really good question, and you should always ask yourself this question, is that if you're telling me stuff out of the Old Testament, why should I think it belongs to us? Why should I think it's not Israel? Okay. And these chapters here, I've spent time in these chapters on the last Jeremiah 46. We're not going to read all of them. Just going to brief them. But these chapters are some of the most depressing chapters I've ever read in my entire life. It took me like 2 months to get through them. 7 chapters, 2 months. Wow. Yeah, that's pretty pathetic. So I'm either a really rotten reader, or I didn't really want to read all the stuff it said because it's really horrible stuff. But let's just kind of go over the top of it. The prophecy against Egypt. in fact. That's chapter one.
Chapter what?
Chapter 47. I'm just going through the Jeremiah, chapter 46. Okay, I'm just kind of... The prophecy against Philistia and Phoenicia.
Verse?
48. I'm leaving out a verse. I'm just reading the chapter titles. Okay. So you can get an idea of what's going on here. Prophecy concerning against Moab. And he goes through and he breaks them all. The prophecy concerning the Ammonites, Edom. I mean, they just go on and on. Judah's included, of course. Babylonia's included. They just go on and on. And if you read these things, it tells how God's wrath on those countries take men, women, and children and destroy them. Okay? And he does that because they live, they're idol worshippers, and they do everything against God. Okay? So God punishes them. He wipes them out. One of the reasons, it can sound cruel, but if God does not wipe them out, the world will be destroyed. When God intervenes, like in a world war, it is on the edge of total destruction. And God actually intervenes on it and wipes out sometimes millions of people to fix that. Mm. And if you know what's happened after these wars, you have a time of peace. You have a time of, guess what, revival. One of the greatest revivals in this country was the Civil War. Mm-hmm. Isn't that strange? One of the most decadent times was before the Civil War. Okay, so that's what God does. That's what he's doing there. He is protecting the human race. He's protecting people. If you look at, we've talked about this before, if you look at the Israelites when they go in with Joshua and God tells them, wipe them all out. Wipe all of them out. Men, women, children. Chop up the plants, you know. That's facetious. But he tells them that so that the influence of those people will not destroy his people and their new promised land. Everybody remember what happens when he doesn't do that? Gibeonites, I think, is one of my favorites. But when he doesn't do that, what happens to the Israelites? You know? You remember your history?
They do what they do.
They start practicing with the phallic cult, which means worshiping a penis, just to kind of make that real clear. They have complete debauchery. They murder their children, and they burn them to death as part of the religious ritual. That's what they do. That's what happens to them. They become like them. And God sits there and says, if you do not destroy these people, who are actually the Canaanites, the most wicked people in the world, if you do not, they will come back and they will haunt you and you will be like them, which is exactly what happens over and over again. Anytime they don't obey God, that's what happens. Okay?
It's what is happening today.
It's what's happening today, yeah. And the reality is that... this sounds strange. We talked about it last week. Our intolerance with sin and evil has to be within the church. Okay? Paul said that last week, if you remember that. Not that Paul. The other Paul. I was looking at what I said then. I thought, okay, wait a minute. I can clean that up. If you remember what he says, he says, I don't want you to go out and try to judge the world. I mean, if you try to judge the world, they're supposed to be evil. That's what they're supposed to be. They chose that. When we were out there, we were too. That's what we were. There's nothing I read in the Bible that surprises me. Nothing. It's the same stuff. It's the stuff that people do who don't believe. They don't have a reason to. Okay. So what he is saying in the scriptures is that we need to clean our own house. When a church like this church tolerates evil and false doctrine, it destroys that church. When the Bible talks in 1 Corinthians, I think it's 15, where it says bad company corrupts good character. You're supposed to help me with that. I made him memorize that over and over. That isn't talking about the world, that's talking about believers. Yeah, the church. That's talking about the church. That's right. The church is the one we will fall for the most. When people tell you rubbish that is not true about Christianity, most likely people who will accept it will be believers because they don't compare it to the Word of God. That's all you have to do. You have to compare everything we're talking about here to the Word of God. That's the truth. There is no other truth. There's no person who stands for the truth other than Jesus Christ and the Word of God. Nobody. Let God be true and every man
a liar.
A liar, that's right, that's because that's how we're brought. Okay, so let's go to Revelation 14, 2. Nope. There we go. Because this shows up in other places too. Oh, with 144,000, that's right. Let me see, why did I pick this verse? I'm trying to remember why I picked this verse. Oh, there we go, it's the rushing water. Okay, got it. And I heard a sound from heaven like the roaring, rushing waters and the loud peals of thunder. the sound I heard was like the harpist playing their harps. And he's talking about this rushing water that we're making a parallel to here. And the reason that this is important is that it is the peace that is just before the fall of Babylon. So when you see that stuff, sometimes it's just the Lord talking, because his voice does come out. But when you see it in verses, especially the 144,000 who are the evangelists of the tribulation, they are also completely against Babylon, which Babylon is it's what we would call ecumenical religion. It's religion in common. Does that make sense?
And the Jehovah's Witnesses use this quite frequently.
Yes, that's right. The only problem is there's more than 144,000. Well, I'd be worried if I were
when they came to my door, I said, whatever happened to the folks that before your church was invented?
Yeah.
And then there's a spillover. What are you going to do with those folks?
Yeah. Are you in the 144? That's what I'd be asking.
Does ever answer you, do they?
No, they don't.
There's only 144,000. So this is another point piece pointing to
the
Lord. Let's go to Ezekiel 124. It says, when the creatures moved, I heard the sound of their wings, like the roar of rushing waters, like the voice of the Almighty, like the tumult of an army. And that's the part we're getting to, is that like the tumult of an army. That's what it has. And if you remember this piece, where this comes from, just for a reference point, this comes from Ezekiel. When Ezekiel is in Babylonia, he is already captured. He is part of the, if you remember this one, remember I told you Daniel was in the first one? Ezekiel in the second one. And that's when he preaches this. That's when he has this vision. This is the vision of the glory of the Lord leaving the temple. Okay? But it has this exact same wording in it. And then Ezekiel 43:2-3.
Didn't he have a revival in a boneyard?
You gotta share those jokes with us.
I just said, doesn't he have a revival in a boneyard?
That's right. And he's going to. It's going to happen. 43:2-3. Is that 42?
Mm-hmm. The glory returns to the temple.
43:2-3. This is the Lord coming back to the filling of the temple, the temple itself. He says, and I saw the glory of the Lord of Israel coming from the east, and his voice was like the roar of rushing waters, and the land was radiant in his glory. And this is after, this is the vision that would happen just before before the Battle of Armageddon is finished. Okay, this is when the Lord himself comes back to the temple. So if you had the time frame up there, you'd have the second coming, and then you would have this vision actually taking place. The Lord, after this battle in that discipline, if you remember, it's 60 days in here. Most scholars believe it's the 60 days before the sheep and the goat and the Jews. But this right here is the greatest battle in history, which was later
Armageddon.
This piece in here. Yeah, Armageddon. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that where Gog and Magog is at?
No, Magog. Gog and Magog is actually right. The Gog and Magog rebellion is right here.
Oh, okay.
It's at the end of the thousand-year reign. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's actually a reference to Gog and Magog, a reference to north. And north of Israel is actually what would be Russia today. So, won't be then, but that's where it's at. It comes up in other places. And let's go through Revelation 19.
You're moving right along.
I know. I love this. I think that's a scary thought.
It's kind of like rushing waters.
Kind of like rushing. You're so funny. She's so cute. Okay, sorry about that. We'll get back on track here. This is the part where it says, "And I heard the sound of the great multitude, like the rushing water, like the rushing waters, and like the loud peal of thunder, shouting, 'Hallelujah!'" This is actually this piece here is still reference to the Lord, and it's just before. If you know when this is taking place, this is actually taking place right here. Okay, that's the piece that's taking that we're hearing about here in 19:2. This is the rapture here. Here's a trip. 7 years, 3.5, 3.5. And then the second piece of that verse, 15. We've got 15. We're actually going to run through this again in the next verse, in the next verse. In 15 here, we say, "Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations." And this is the part where, from here, when this is finished, this is only 7 years, judgment seat of Christ, this is what happens next. So it follows immediately with that reference. You're always finding it around armies, you're always finding it around national or even worldwide discipline. Okay. Any questions before we go to the next verse?
How'd you do that?
Good. Okay, so in the next verse, verse 16, it says, "In his right hand he held 7 stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun, shining in all of its brilliance." This is the 17th appearance and the final appearance of a Christophany that's recorded in the Bible. Okay, so this is the last farewell, final piece, and it does actually show up through the book of Revelation, but it actually takes place in a very short period of time on the island of Patmos. Okay. So let's read the English part. Kind of mess around with the Greek part here, because it has some things in it. It says, "And having," so you can, it would be technically, "and having in his right hand stars," the 7 stars, "and out of his mouth a broad sword." And let me see, what is that piece? "A broad sword, double-edged, sharp." I'm just reading it in its order. The Greek order, like we've talked about, is not the same as ours. But the nice thing about reading it in the Greek order is it is, there's a word for it. What's it called? It's kind of chopped up. There's a better word for that. I can't remember what it is. But it's kind of chopped up. And what it does do is it forces you, when I say it, to think about the words, which is what my real goal is to kind of make you think about the words. Then the next word here is proceeding, meaning coming out, with the word coming out. But it is always used, this word when it comes out, is always used for divine discipline. This word in the Greek is always used for divine discipline. It doesn't show up any other reference other than that one. And his overt appearance, that's what that next word means, is like the sun that shines in the power, in his power, it says in his power. And this is the power, and the power it's talking about here in Revelation is the power of, it's the power of Jesus. Who he's seeing here is Jesus, because you can't see the second person, right? Mm-hmm. No, you can't see the second person of God. You can't see God at all. Okay. But you can see Jesus. And in this case, this is the glorified Christ. And this power that the glorified Christ has is actually the filling of the Holy Spirit and God himself. And the problem is that what we're doing here is we're trying to dissect something so we can understand it that actually cannot be dissected. That's the nice thing about God's Word. Sometimes when you say something, you can say it like it's separate, but in reality, it's never separate. It's like when you talk about Jesus, the reference to Jesus is to his humanity. Okay, but in reality, Jesus' humanity is never separated from either the Holy Spirit or from the second person of God. That makes sense? So a lot of times when you're talking about stuff, it's kind of important to talk about it so you can understand that the person that we are seeing in this vision is Jesus Christ, the glorified man. Okay? We're not seeing God the Father. We're not seeing God the Son. We're not seeing God the Holy Spirit. Yet, they are completely and perfectly in unity. Okay? At all times. So this is the power it's talking about right here. When it's talking about the power, it's talking about the power of the person of Christ. But it's also talking about the same power that he had both before and after the resurrection. This is the same power that Jesus the man told the disciples about to wait for
the counselor.
The power, yeah, the counselor, the power. Remember he said, stay in Jerusalem, don't leave until you get the power. Okay? Why is that important? Because this is our power too. Identical. No difference. God the Father did not, when God the Father gave this to Jesus' humanity, okay, he had a very specific purpose in it. You should be asking yourself, well, why did he need the power of the Holy Spirit if he had the power of the second person? They're equal, right? Right? Yeah, they are. They're equal. They're both God. There's nothing the second person doesn't have that the Holy Spirit doesn't have. There's nothing the Holy Spirit doesn't have that the second person doesn't have. And there's nothing that the first and the second don't have that the Father doesn't have. So why go through this? Why does he need this? It's a begging question. Because remember we're talking about here the knowledge part, the mystery doctrine? Because this is the holy life. This piece in our life is the holy life. It is the only life. It is the mystery doctrine. It is the part that is required of us to live. If you do not live a life filled with the Holy Spirit, you do not live a Christian life. You live another life. Maybe you live a nice guy life. It doesn't mean your salvation is gone. It just means that you have no power. You're missing it. You have no effective power. What you do is nice, but it dies in the time that you live. This power has the same power that Jesus had that lasts forever. So this is why it's critical. This is why it's critical for us to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to reconcile ourselves. When we find ourselves doing, we reconcile ourselves so that we can be filled with the Holy Spirit to have that power to change things in an eternal, godly manner. Without it, we are just people. Okay? With no effectiveness and no significance. Okay, so where are we now? Okay. Got lots of stuff to do here, right? So this is the power it's talking about. It's called dunamis. Dunamis is the word for dynamo, which is the same word for dynamite. It's power. Okay, what's the word comes from? Let's see if we can get a little bit further down here. We got like two whole minutes. Lots of time. So what we want to look at, one of the things I want to look at right now is the word here, and we'll have a time to talk about it. This word double-edged sword is a very interesting word. The problem is there's two words for sword. And I should take a picture of that first, but never mind. There's two words for sword. Okay, one of them is called Machaira, and the other one is called Rumphaira. Okay? Now those are the Greek words for sword. Okay? They're very different. The word we have here is Rumphaira. And the word we have, where else is it? It's another piece of text. This is the word Rumphaira here too. Rumphaira is a big, long sword that the barbarians used, and it had two swords in it. It was very heavy, okay? So it was really hard to do battle with it. But God always uses that word. Whenever you look behind the word sword and you find the word Rumphaira, which is the word we have here, it means divine discipline. That is the purpose of that sword. Now, the Machaira was a sword that the Romans came up with against the Rumphaira. Okay? So you have the heathens coming into the Roman Empire. And here the Romans have this little tiny sword. They have two of them, actually. And what the nice thing about the sword is that they figured they can conquer the barbarians with these little swords. Did they?
Yes.
Yeah, they carved out a kingdom that was the biggest empire in world history. Second to nobody. And the longest time, second to nobody. Okay? But the word Machaira is a word that's used in this one right here. Okay? And this word, let's look it up for a second. Hebrews 4:12. So we can get the difference between these two. I don't know why Hebrew always hides from me. Just in time. 4:12. The Word of God is living and active and sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow. It judges the heart and the attitudes. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. And that's, if you think about how sharp the blade is talking about here, this is the Machaira. Whenever God is blessing you and revealing something to you, He uses the Machaira. Whenever you are being disciplined, you get the Ramphira. And you'll find that true in every reference to sword. The problem is, our word sword is sword. Yeah, it's just sword. We can't tell until we look behind it. But if you look at the context, you can tell which one it's using. Okay. The other part is that this sword is so sharp that it divides, it says it's dividing between the soul
and the spirit.
And the spirit. You know how much width there is between the soul and the spirit? Maybe most of us can't tell. Most of us, if I asked you for a definition of both, would not be able to say what they are. That's how close they are. They're intimate. Okay? They're intimate. They're intimately wrapped in each other. When you become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Himself, the Holy Spirit, gives you a human spirit, and it wraps with your soul, and it actually has eternal life. So if you don't have, if you just have a soul, you'll have life forever, but guess where it'll be? So you want this baby on here, okay? And this is the one that gives us eternal life. This is the one that allows us to serve God, to understand Him, because otherwise we have no mentality. We don't have the ability. So the human spirit wraps it up, and that is what that sword is talking about, dividing. It's so sharp. It is something that divides attitudes of the heart. It divides soul and spirit. It's very, very discerning. Mm-hmm. It is something that we have, that God has given to us, to know how to walk with Him. Okay? So, let's end it there. Any questions? We'll come back and finish up this verse next week. Let's pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, I can't thank You enough when I just think about the fact that You've given us Your Holy Spirit. You've given us power. You've given us godly power. Nothing can match it. And when we fail and when we get afraid, we can hide in that power. You will protect us with that power. You help us understand Your Word. I pray, Lord, that You'll help us to seek You, to be in that 6%, to be that remnant that loves You with all of our heart, that seeks in Your Word, and that throws ourselves on Your mercy and humility, because that is the only way we get to know who You are. Even as Christians, we want to be effective. We want to make a change. We want Your plan to be active in our personal lives. I ask this in Jesus' name, who did that absolutely perfectly and followed Your plan perfectly. In Your truth and Your power. In His name, amen. Amen. Amen.